One of the things I want to point out too, Reg, in the mid 80s, when we had a few of those overweight fighters, like excuse me, in the heavyweight division in particular, we were beginning to see a few of those men who would come in out of shape and everything. I ran those names off already. But what happened is, one guy came along, Mike Tyson, and the way he performed in the ring, the way he looked in the ring, because he was in shape, you know, he was quick of hands and foot, he was elusive, he had power, and he made those guys in the division, some of them were on their way out. You know, they had had their careers already, and he was the young guy because he was like 21 years old, popping up on the scene, beating up on these veteran men, some former and recent former champions. But when they saw him, including the guys who may be coming up, the Tyrell Biggses and, you know, the likes of that, those guys start to get themselves into shape, Reggie, because they were like, I don't want to be embarrassed. You understand? Even though Tyson was doing what he was doing to people, he set a precedent that if you go in there and you're looking sloppy and everything, he's just going to make you look even worse. So at least the least you could do is to come in some type of physical shape, huh? And conditioning, read being in shape, sometimes will allow you to overcome something, to be enduring, to be a person that can possibly prevail because you have sculpted yourself to a point of being able to deal with what's at hand. When you don't try to make yourself meet a precedent where you go out and you say, I have a goal, I need to meet this goal, and you don't, and you just say, F it, you know, I'm not gonna do that. What in the world makes you think that someone like me, that I spend my money to watch these fights and stuff, gonna spend my money to watch you? It's crazy. That's backwards thinking. And why should someone give you a chance when you go out there and you're looking like Harry Hippo and you ain't trying? Listen, for as great a boxer he was, Tony Tubbs was a heavyweight champion and a quickly former heavyweight champion due to external things in his career outside the ring. But the man could box. The story has it that he was like a 16-year-old kid roaming his neighborhood with a pair of gloves thrown over his shoulder, challenging grown men to box him for a few dollars. And he was whooping all of their butts. Tony Tubbs could box. But he had a thing where not being in shape was more important to him than anything. So he would come into the ring and be grossly overweight, still being able to box, but not being able to be the best he could be. And on the night that he went in there with Mike Tyson in Tokyo, Japan, back in 1989, I believe that was, he went in there, and he was stopped in two rounds by Mike Tyson. And I think the only reason he made it two rounds was because he could box. Tony Tubbs could really box. Go back and look at his fight against Riddick Bowe. And that's years after Mike Tyson. I think at least, what was that, maybe 4 years later? 3 years later? He gave Bowe all he could handle. And Bowe is 6'5". 225 pounds when he fought Tony Tubbs. But we're talking about in the fight against Bo, he came in much better shape. shape that he was closer to when he had won a title. But when he went in there with Mike Tyson, he was 240 something pounds. We're talking about a man who's 6 foot two and a half, and the frame he had, he shouldn't have been over 225, 28 pounds like that. That was his, that's where he should have been. Fast hands, great combinations, tremendous jab. I mean, Tony Tubbs was a really good fighter, but he just couldn't stay in shape. I mean, when you're out there getting hit in the head for a living, man, you need all your faculties. And a lot of guys leave this sport not only with their without their lives in some instances, but they lose their faculties from being hit in the head. So it's like, that's an oxymoron right there. It's like you need to do your best when you're in there. How are you in your at your best in boxing and you're 300 pounds? And this is not just about heavyweights, because if you're fighting at 147 pounds, but you're walking around at 200 pounds, it speaks the same of you. The reason that you don't fight often is because you have to work too darn hard with fat camps, losing 50 pounds to make a weight. And now you're seeing more than ever before, I think, in the history of the sport. So many guys are missing weight and losing titles on the scales. It's ridiculous, because they're like, F it. I'm just going to see what they do. If they take my title on the scales, if they find me, you know, I can deal with that. What? Where is your pride? Where is your sensibility? Where is your dignity? Going in there looking like a mountain of bullcrap. And you stink too. Because nobody wants to see you stink up the joint, coming out there looking all lethargic and everything, and laying on the opponent and laying up against the ropes and everything. It's like, we got a sport called WWE, huh? Where we could go watch the real wrestlers, huh? Not you coming out there looking like a snail or something. It's ridiculous, bro. And we have to talk about that. We have to expose it. We have to make these guys understand that that's not acceptable. Go back and look at tapes of guys from the 70s, huh? Just before the early 80s, you know, just before Larry Holmes' reign, look at the fighters. Go back and look at the films. Look at what kind of shape they were in. Then the 80s happened, and you could see that guys coming in there looking like doughboys. And then after Mike Tyson came on the scene, look at how guys were back in shape again. Think about it. Tyson, Holyfield, Lewis, that whole era of guys, they were in shape. And the ones who weren't didn't meet up to their, full potential. The Ray Mercers, the Tommy Morrisons, Bruce Seldons, those guys, they didn't measure up because they didn't do what they were supposed to do. Tommy Morrison was probably one of the best Caucasian heavyweights in the modern times. But outside the ring, he had his problems too. He couldn't stop doing certain things that ended up taking him up out of here. It's just something that has to be said, Reggie, and it's something that has to be focused on more so than the purses. More so than who is A and B side, more so than who got clout, who got the most social media people and all of that foolishness. Because where are all the social media people when you get your behind handed to you? They on to the next one. Huh? What you got, Reg?
Man, OG. Hey, you delivered on that one. I can't even touch on it and shouldn't touch on it because you delivered some great points and even bring it up with what Mike Tyson did to change the game, change the aspect of how them heavyweights came out to the look and everything about these lower division fighters ballooning up in weight and not staying close to their fighting weights. No, 200-pound welterweights walking around like that. That stuff makes no sense. But man, you killed that. I don't even want to touch over that.
Yeah, man, it's the truth. You know what I'm saying? All it takes is for somebody to come along and start cleaning house, right? And then people, just like the old saying, when the cat's away, the mice will play. It's like someone like Tyson come along and people was like, man, I gotta do my road work. I gotta jump this road. They trying to get their stuff together because they like, if I gotta get in there with that dude and he knocking people heads off and stuff, at least I want to be able to move around the ring and get the hell out of the way. You know what I'm saying? So yes, it happened that way. Marvin Hagler at middleweight, people was like, oh, he should move up, or why don't he move up and fight Michael Spinks? Well, why do he need to move up and fight Michael Spinks when he's doing so well where he is, and when he's not fighting, he's only about 12 pounds heavier walking around than when he fights? Look at Sugar Ray Leonard today. Look at how small and thin Sugar Ray is. Look at him. He looked like he's only about 15 pounds heavier than when he fought. And you go back and look in history and you see guys like Wilfredo Gomez and stuff like that. Wilfredo Gomez, when he fought at lightweight and down there at super featherweight and stuff like that, when he was fighting, he was a ripped guy and knocking people heads off, had the thick mustache and everything and a full head of hair. You see him now, dude is like 200 plus pounds. And I'm not saying that that's a bad thing about him, but I'm saying that when he was fighting at his weight, how he maintained, right? How Leonard maintained, how Hagler maintained. This is how they did. And you could see for those who weren't able to keep their discipline, even in retirement, you could see that certain people, it became a way of life for them. That's why they can walk around and still look good. Like Marvin Hagler still looks great today. Ray Leonard still looks great today. You know what I mean? It's like because they maintained it. It was a way of life for them. That's how they were able to compete in that ring the way that they did, because the mental conditioning along with the physical conditioning, there was a marriage. The only thing these dudes are married to today is the supersize me and the steaks. Huh? That's what they married to. It's ridiculous. You watching two fat dudes. You might as well be watching sumo wrestling from Japan. Godzilla versus King Kong. It's a movie I seen. They got a movie coming. It's a trailers everywhere. That's what they look like. Two big Titanic monsters in the ring. Only thing you needed to put around them was some small buildings or something like that. And you'd be like, that's a Japanese monster movie right there we watching. That's what they look like. Disgraceful. You talk about them fighting for a belt? If they won a belt, the belt wouldn't even fit around their waist. Get out of here. Man, but that's about it, Reg. I don't have any more on this foolishness, man, and we can get on out of here. We've spent enough time keeping people up, and, you know, it's been a night of boxing that it's like, you know, it was so-so. It was so-so. And it wasn't good for me simply because I had that problem with the buffering, but I figured this out. It's like the storm. It's got to be. But when I get that that equipment that I'm expecting in the mail this week, I should have no more problems with this. But yeah, well, go ahead and give us some final thoughts, Reg, and let everybody know where they could follow you and subscribe to your channel.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir, man. Another great live, man. Another great post fight, man. Salute to the OG, both of the OGs, just yourself, OG Storm B, man, and OG Curtis Anderson, man. Great, great discussion, man. And you hit solid on that point with when you get someone who comes in here and they take the sport serious and they're putting in all that proper work, it forces these other guys to become a better version of themselves. It forces them. And you also see what happens when those who don't give great account of themselves, but they want to be up there, they cheat them their way up. And that's where the science has to be involved into shortcutting that type of activity going on into the game, because you get too many of those not willing to put in the full aspects of keeping themselves in top gear shape that they pull this stuff off. And those who put in the great efforts of doing everything properly, raising the stakes, putting divisions on their back, bringing great presentations to what's performed in front of people, that make people willing to put and shell out money to watch what's going on because they're entertained and they respect every aspect of what's being delivered. Salute to y'all. And y'all who come up in these fights looking like chewed up bubblegum, please step out the ring, step away from the sport, sit on the couch, talk it like we talk it, and stop presenting this stuff. And promoters, stop putting these type of people on the events, because you sell the sports short. You really sell the sports short. And stop giving these opportunities fighters who walk around in these lower divisions way out of rank. Because you even seeing where you was talking about the fighters missing weight, kind of on a it's becoming such a common occurrence, but these fighters are missing weight by like 3, 4, 5. You even seen a guy missing by 8 pounds. That's the ridiculousness of what people aren't putting in, because they're too distracted. One check comes into these dudes and they lose their dang minds. They forget how the money was made and how more of it can be made and how more of it can be gained and made. But great, great live, man. Oh.